Please go ahead, sir. We are live now.
A very good afternoon to all. I have great pleasure in welcoming our chairman, Mr. Lav Chaturvedi, chairman of the National Council on Capital Market, ASSOCHAM. My special welcome to all the eminent speakers from international. Mr. Robin Steeves, Professor Mathan Rotti, Mr. Tom, Mr. Ajay Kumar, Ajay Mathur, and of course the eminent speakers, Mr. Jigar Shah, Mr. Pankaj Chopra, Dr. Saurav Agarwal, Mr. Atul Gupta. We will not be having this time Mr. S.C. Agarwal. I just got a message that he is stuck in another meeting of his, in his office, some important work. So he will not be able to make it this time. But we have a very, very, you know, strong panel of eminent speakers look at this subject from the international perspective, and it's a huge, huge one. And we are, you know, lucky to have the international eminent personalities today among other experts. And I am sure that all the participants will be benefited out of it. So with this, as you know, we have been organizing a series of discussions on the capital market every month. Sometimes it is commodity, sometimes capital market, and we are discussing each and every aspect of this. And this series is going on for 1 year and so, and we are grateful to the chairman of the council for taking this forward, and all the members of ASSOCHAM, our international friends, those who are always available, especially Mr. Mathur. So welcome once again to everyone. And now I request Chairman Mr. Lav Chaturvedi to kindly moderate the session, conduct the proceedings. Thank you so much.
Hello, panelists. Would like to personally welcome each one of you, Jigar, Ajay, Robin, Tom, Gianluca, Pankaj, Saurav, Atul. Thank you so much for joining us today. We will miss Mr. Agarwal, but you know, we definitely know, you know, the next one he will be able to join. I would like to thank all the participants, and the topic today is a very pertinent topic, is from the foreign participation, the international perspective on our market. Our markets are what they are. Whoever is following this market would probably either be too excited or too puzzled, but whatever it is, it's keeping all of us on our toes. And one of the key pillars of our markets is the foreign participation. We all know that if India ought to become a 5 trillion economy in over next couple of years, or maybe reach and will be reaching the top three in the world stack, probably over this decade itself, then one area where we have to ensure that we get things right is the foreign participation, is the international perspective. It carries a lot of weight in what we do in India. From the participation perspective, I'm not just talking about the equity market, I'm actually talking about the overall capital markets and the larger financial markets, be it the bond markets, the currency, the commodities, the credit market, all has to come together, and along with equity, all have to come together if we really ought to propel and get the requisite risk capital for the growth of our economy and for our industries. As you may know, that our fellow panelists, and we will ensure we try to do best with keeping up with the time, but I want to just highlight two or three larger areas, and then we will probably go specifics. We all know that we have more than 10,000 foreign in the portfolio investors, over $600 billion of their AUM in the equity class, one third of the free float, have lot of impact on our equity in market for sure, and their participation in the larger markets like bond markets and other with the larger participation coming is going to grow multifold. So maybe we are going to go to each of the panelists and probably going to seek some specifics of what they feel if we have to really take it from here and make India as a preferred destination from the experience perspective and from the returns perspective, because those two are, and experience is more about ease, stable, you know, legal environment, compliances, operational experience, so overall experience, and then the return perspective. These two will play key roles. In addition to that, there are a lot of other ancillary things like the capital account convertibility, the taxation, the foreign sector limits, the legal stability, which I mentioned about, developing the credit markets, getting the currency market, getting GIFT City play in there, because it's outside in, but inside out. So how does the GIFT City can play a larger role cohesively to develop these markets? So these are the few of the areas that we have, as we all know, that as recent as 2019 and that has continued, that some of the largest steps that has been taken by doing away with the broad-based criteria, by doing away with the opaque structures, by providing some stability in the legal construct, by simplifying the categorization of the FPIs. So a lot of work has gone in this area, you know, by the regulators as well. And as we are seeing this area progressing and getting wider participation, I know that we are still awaiting our bonds to, you know, get incorporated in the global benchmarks, and that will probably open up some of the funding stream as well. But today, let's just open up about things that can get more funding stream to India in various asset classes. What are the things that we ought to do? What are the things we are doing right, which can be at least kept where we are or further strengthened? And what are the things that we need to improvise upon and provide some recommendation to the relevant authorities and ensure that we have a one robust foreign participation across our markets? With that note, I will begin today's journey with Jigar. Jigar is the managing director of Maybank Kim Eng India. They cater to large sector of the FPIs and are very active in this space in India for quite some time. I would, Jigar, if you could just share your experience and give some perspective on few key pointers that what you believe that we can strengthen and then take it forward, that would be great for all of us. Jigar, over to you.
Hi, good evening to all of you. Am I audible?
Sir. Okay.
So thank you to ASSOCHAM for inviting me on this panel. And what I would do is try and summarize some of the feedback I get from my colleagues in Singapore and Malaysia. We are mainly an ASEAN specialized bank, but we operate our investment banking and broking business globally with a significant amount of partnerships in Asia, US and UK. Some of the most important things about the Indian capital market and foreign participation is that, I mean, it's been existing for a number of decades. It's one of the most important emerging markets globally for the foreign investors. And over time, several regulations have been simplified. I think the FPI categories and registration, etc., has also been simplified a lot over a period of time, which has enabled a good amount of flows. In fact, we have seen record flows in the last couple of years, and it has made our markets more vibrant. In terms of private equity, also we have seen a significant amount of flows in chosen sectors. That also makes India a very sought after market in terms of the startups, and it helps in terms of the entrepreneurships in India. India is considered to be sort of a small entrepreneur capital of the world, and we are now seeing with the Zomato listing, the startup ecosystem also having an impact on the secondary market. So this is a unique thing which is happening, and which gives a new hope for fundraising and eventually that impacting our economy on a very positive note. GIFT City will of course enable more foreign investment to come, and the alternative investment funds, they are also going to help as a product in a big way to the foreign investors looking into India. Now, where we see the development not so great is the area of the debt market. And there, probably it's only the government debt market which is sort of well invested, but the private, you know, corporate debt market is not that well invested. And I'll come to the green bond market in a minute, but just want to add that, you know, there are also many countries which do not have a great deal of investment into India, where there is a lot of capacity and capability, but for some reasons, maybe a lack of a greater knowledge, these countries have not really done so much out here. So when I look at ASEAN and India, there are you know, many similarities and proximities, but probably with the exception of Singapore, there's not so much amount of FDI or FPI which is happening. However, I see that there is a very good prospect in the form of ESG and sustainability, which is now emerging, and everyone needs to pay attention to the climate risk. All the countries have their own pledges, and they need this green stroke sustainable finance market. So that opens up a great deal of new avenue for the investors as well as the corporate, and it can work as a very good bridge, because most investors globally are getting adhere to the principles of responsible investment, and they are looking for more and more avenues to invest in companies and industries which are more sustainable. And corporates are also having their own obligations as a matter of risk management and as a matter of their own growth, and to protect and improve their market capitalization, to strengthen their business, they also need to raise finance so that they can progress on the path of sustainability in line with the net zero goals by 2050 for the whole world. So I think that when we look at the data for green stroke sustainable bonds, transition bonds in the world market, I think it has reached about $1 trillion. But when we look at the participation of India and ASEAN, it is very small at this point of time. And if you look at even Asia level, I think the large amount of flow is in China. So this is where I feel, you know, there is a huge scope for Indian companies to attract a lot of funds, both in terms of equity and debt. And I think there should be a more specific taxonomy device for India, because there is going to be a huge amount of transition activity in India, and there is a need for technology over here. There is a need for finance for deploying that technology and foreign collaboration. So I feel, you know, India needs to take a step on this. And there are obviously already existing guidelines, but I see that because of the taxonomy differential all over the world, this market has not developed as well as it should. And there is a sort of urgency over here in terms of the next 10 years, the kind of requirement of energy efficiency, new technology and new products which are emission friendly, as well as renewable sector, which is going into a big new scale. There can be a big efficient sourcing of capital from the foreign shores, which India can do. And I think that probably may require efforts at the government or regulator level in terms of doing roadshows and making, you know, people in ASEAN, that is our market. I mean, we can definitely have a connect where there can be roadshows from India level to represent that what kind of opportunities exist in terms of sectors, in terms of the government companies, as well as the private companies or the bodies such as ASSOCHAM. So that's something which I feel is a big area where there can be foreign capital which can be used for the win-win purpose. And one more thing I see in a related opportunity is the development of carbon trading markets, because you know, a lot of the emerging markets will provide the offsets which will be required for the large sectors who are not able to cut down all their emissions, and therefore they would need offsets in terms of the nature-based solutions as well as in terms of the renewables, for an efficient price discovery they would also require a carbon trading, where I've recently heard that one of the state in India is going to pilot this kind of a scheme. So I believe that you know, carbon trading will develop as a very big asset class going forward, and India is a very large country and one of the largest emitters, should also have something of its own in this area. So these are some of my initial thoughts, I'll stop here and would be happy to contribute later, but thanks for this opportunity. Love, you are on mute.
Thank you. Yeah, thanks a lot, Jigar. And there's a lot to contribute in this space, the $1 trillion opportunity, and we haven't even begun yet, just on this small one part. Imagine if we across the class, what are the opportunities that we are looking at? Thanks, Jigar. We'll definitely come back to the more participation. I would now like to go over to Ajay. Ajay, you brings a lot of interesting perspective from the commodity side, as being a metal specialist, and may just want to give you a perspective as to, you know, specific in the commodities but larger space, what are the inputs, Ajay, that we can take forward. Over to you, Ajay.
Thank you very much, Love, for inviting me over. It's always a pleasure to be part of ASSOCHAM webinars and contribute with my ideas and suggestions. And continuing in the same theme, I think we all agree on what the reality on the ground is when it comes to the capital markets or the larger financial markets in India. I would just like to present it a little differently. One is in terms of potential, and B is in terms of challenges. Yep. So when it comes to the potential of the markets in India, we all know that India is a large economy. Our population is both a challenge as well as an opportunity for the country. And so long as we are able to convert that into an opportunity, that bodes well for the country. It's not just the numbers, it's what benefits India is the entrepreneurship, the innovative nature of the people, the IT and the fintech space that we are so active in. India is the IT capital of the world. And these are all very, very positives for the Indian economy. There is a large domestic market with younger and higher risk taking investors in the country. There is a regulatory framework in place, SEBI, RBI, et cetera. All these are very good at this point in time. So international investors are keeping an eye on the Indian market. Are they really into the Indian market? Are they really investing? Are they really interested in coming into and putting their money on the table? That is what I would like to cover in the challenges part. So yes, we have a lot of good potential in India. A lot of these factors have been mentioned by Jigar just now, so I don't want to repeat any of those. In terms of the challenges, what we have to first understand, who are we trying to attract here? These are all large investors. So they are pension firms, they are hedge funds, they are institutional investors, and we're talking about getting millions and billions of dollars of investment into the country. And what would bring that into India? So you have to win the trust and confidence of these investors before they invest into the country. What will bring that trust and confidence? So you need to have political stability in the country. They don't care whether BJP is in power or Congress is in power or which other political party is in power. What they're looking for is the sustainability of policies, whether, you know, one change in government will change the policies of the country, and therefore they may have to relook at their investments. We look at the legal infrastructure, legal framework, and when we talk about the legal infrastructure and framework, we look at what the precedences are, or what have Indian courts in the past decided when it came to different court cases. These are all factors that affect the investor's confidence and whether they would like to invest into the country or not. You have to look at the operational framework. You have to look at the FX markets. You have to look at the commodities markets. They're all part of the overall ecosystem of a country, of an economy, and which need to be addressed. Then we have to look at the governance and sustainability that Jigar mentioned about. Yes, we have the infrastructure in place. We have the SEBIs and RBIs in place. What is the enforcement like? We have the policies. How are these enforced? That is of concern to investors. Just the presence of a framework doesn't help. Yes, that's the first step. You have to make a beginning somewhere. That beginning was made several years ago. But now what is the enforcement? That is key to affecting the confidence of an international investor. Then it comes to the structural improvements that India can make. So I would like to give an example from the precious metals industry that recently there was an IPO from a jewelry company, which was launched. Now, if international investors have to invest into that IPO, they would look at several other things. They would say, in the international precious metals markets, what is important is the responsible sourcing of gold, for instance. They look at the governance, they look at the environmental impact, they look at the child labor, they look at whether the funding is legal or not, whether it is funding drug trafficking, terrorist financing activities, etc., and so many other things. They all are covered under the OECD guidelines when it comes to responsible sourcing. Now, this Indian company which is launching the IPO may be doing all of this voluntarily, but does India have its own responsible sourcing guidelines as a country? No, it doesn't. I was part of the OECD committee that was drafting those guidelines, but I don't know whether those have been implemented in India or not. And if yes, then who's going to be enforcing that and how the enforcement is going to be? Once these things are addressed at the macro level, then these things will trickle down to the company level, the corporate level, and the investor level. And that is going to bring the confidence of investors internationally, and then they will be willing to put their money into the market. So what we have to do is to take a 360 degree view of what we are doing in terms of the overall structure of the market. And that is where the implementation part, the execution part is very important. And this is how I'd like to put it at this point in time, and we'll take it forward as we go along in this webinar.
Great. Thanks, Ajay. Very informative. Trust and confidence, that's the key. And yes. And how, you know, about the overall responsibility, be it climate, be it social, be it geopolitical, be it cultural, and how and institutionalization of that and enforcement of that is some construct that can be, if put together, can help us achieve what we are aspiring to do. Yeah, definitely look forward to your more participation. I would now like to move to Robin. Robin can give us some good outside in perspective with regard to how the world is looking at and what kind of inputs that can further develop our capital markets, and also give some perspective if on specifically on the overall Brexit and this kind of situation and how it has either helped out or has no impact. So over to you, Robin. Robin, you're there?
Yeah, I'm just trying to get the screen up.
Okay.
Can you see the screen?
Yep, you can.
Perfect. Bear me a second. Right. Well, firstly, thank you very much indeed for the opportunity to speak today. It's a pleasure to join your call. I come with a slightly unusual background insofar as I've been on both sides of the fence. I've been an advisor in capital markets for probably longer than I'd care to think, but certainly back into the last century. But also I'm a chairman of a public company on the AIM market currently, and I'm joining another company as well that's joining the market hopefully later this year. So I've seen both sides of the process. So what I've really done here is look at some of the things that have worked in London. I've looked at some things in of the issues around Singapore and Hong Kong, and therefore, and then based upon that, maybe come back with some ideas as to how that may be informative as to what perhaps the Indian markets need to develop. One topic I didn't even think about actually was Brexit. And truthfully, for me, Brexit wasn't a great idea. But the one good thing about Brexit is I don't think it has any impact on London capital markets. I think that's one area where really Brexit isn't an issue. So I'm pleased to deal with that at the front of the process. So just going through the slides reasonably quickly. So as I say, I'll start first with really, I guess, with what could be learned from London's capital market experience over the last 300 years, although I won't do every year because they weren't all very exciting. But I thought that might be just informative. So I think for both a user as an advisor and also a director of a company, I mean, the thing that works well in London, I think, is a great basis, is that the whole system creates confidence, certainty and consistency in the listing infrastructure. It's evolved over probably 300 years, truthfully, but it moves and it evolves on a regular basis, and it's in line with the economy in terms of practice and in terms of what's happening in the world. So that's certainty, that's consistency is very important. I think also that it's worth making a point that in London you've got access to experienced and independent and well-regulated team of advisors. They're all on the same side. It's not like a merger and acquisition. Anyone involved in an IPO is working together, and they've all got the same sort of mindset about making certain the company is investor ready, is ready to come to market. So whether it's the lawyers, the accountants, the nomads, the brokers, the sponsors, we're all working together to make certain that the company that comes to market is appropriate and is in the best place it can be. I think importantly too, regarding London, the regulations are based on a balance of interests, the balance of interest between the investors and the market entrants, the market users. So again, important that balance is kept in place. Also, clearly the large benefits of one large benefit of London is access to deep pools of capital, both UK capital and international capital. And if you just for this purpose, if you compare, say, the UK to the US, in the US, something like 85% of the money that goes into US companies on their markets comes from UK investors. In the UK, it's only 49%. So effectively 51% of the money that goes into UK listed companies comes from outside. They're US investors, they're European investors, they're Asian investors, and they're investing in through the market because they like the market and they like the infrastructure. And therefore it's a very easy place to do business. The other area where London scores very highly is the strength of the secondary fundraising equity market. So if you look at an example on the AIM market, something like 55% of the money ever raised on AIM, since 1995, I think they've raised over £110 billion. 55% of that has come from secondary or third round fundraising. So that access to capital, not just on the IPO, but afterwards, is a big, big plus. There's also a choice of markets, as there is in India, which again gives companies the choice to be able to come in at the right level, depending upon its size and structure. It certainly welcomes international admissions, obviously an important point going forward for any market. And something like 40% of the companies on London are either overseas companies or the UK companies with a very strong overseas involvement. So again, very, very important. Liquidity is a key point in London, and that's why it's so attractive. And that's encouraged both by effective investor relations, both on the IPO and thereafter, but also ensuring that we have an adequate free float. And I'll come back to free float later on. Corporate governance also clearly important in any market. Again, I think where the UK has got it right is it's based as much on principles as it is on detailed rules. And clearly, companies are encouraged to comply with the best possible practice. But that best possible practice is based upon a company by company assessment as to what's reasonable, depending upon its stage of a development and size. And then the main point in the UK as regards corporate governance is comply or disclose. So either you comply, if you don't comply fully, you disclose why you don't comply and the reasons. And generally that works well. The earlier speakers have talked about sustainability and the green market and ESG. Again, very, very important. And London has made very good strides there, particularly as regards the green economy mark, as have the other markets in the UK. So again, a very important part of it, I think, of any market going forward. So, you know, we need to build back better post COVID and post other issues arising around the world. And in terms of accounting, and I'm by practice an accountant, there's a very balanced compliance requirement, both in terms of admission, but also on an ongoing basis. Once you're on the market in the UK, you're only producing audited accounts once a year, and you're only producing 6 monthly accounts. Quite easy to comply with. The time limits are reasonable, probably much easier to comply with than most other markets. I talked about the stakeholders and the advisors. I won't go through this slide, but it just gives you an aspect of the teams involved. All those teams working together with the client to make certain that the client is appropriate and the company's in the best place to actually get through the IPO. It doesn't always work. And we say to clients, or I say to clients, particularly when looking at working capital, it doesn't matter in 4 years' time if the business fails because of good commercial reasons, because the market changes, you're overtaken, although that's not an ideal situation. But what we can't do is have a company that comes to market and fails within a year or 18 months. So that level of due diligence, that team working, making certain the company is at the right level and at the right stage of development is crucial. In terms of markets, I'm sure that Tom will go into this, maybe perhaps a bit more detail. But for us, I've just actually put on this slide the markets that we use mainly in the UK, and you select the markets based upon the size of the company, the stage of development, the fundraising requirements, and also how long the company has been established. So as you probably know, that in the main market, there are two main elements of that. There's a premium segment and the standard segment. The premium segment is probably the gold standard. Standard segment has been used largely for smaller companies, some overseas companies that have come to market. I'll mention on the slide later on that both the size and the structure of the standard segment has been looked at. But again, those two markets have worked very well. The A market is probably the best known market of a lot in the UK. It's certainly the most successful market for emerging companies in the world. Since 1995, well over 4,000 companies have come through that market. And as I say, in excess of £110 billion has been raised. And it continues to be very successful. It certainly has been very resilient. Well, all the markets in the UK have been very resilient in the last 18 months, time when you would think markets would be under pressure. They've stood the test of time very well, both in terms of secondary fundraising, but also in the last eight or nine months in terms of admissions. And the company which I'm a director, Vector Capital, actually came to market in December 2020 and actually came back to the market and raised more money in July. A really good example of how companies can use the A market. You join the market, but have access to secondary round funding quite quickly. Again, I think something which a market needs to be able to demonstrate for it to be able to differentiate itself. The Aqua Stock Exchange is a relatively new name, but it's a market that's been around in various iterations, again, for the last 25 years. In the last 18 months, has made good strides, and I would place it just below the A market. Maybe it's for smaller companies, slightly emerging companies, but again, quite possible now to go to that market and raise money. So in terms of the UK, you've got a big spread between Aquis, you've got AIM, and then you've got the main market. We covers all angles just about within those markets. You've also got the International Stock Exchange based in the Channel Islands, not technically in the UK, but quite useful for funds, for debt issues, and also for some corporates. Again, it's the emerging markets. In terms of scale, and also it's a useful agent, particularly for companies who want to be offshore. Also on the LSE, there are some specialist markets which I don't plan to cover here. So overall, what makes London work? It makes London, and what actually can differentiate it from the other markets? Why has it been successful for 300 years? Access to capital, clearly very important. The deep pool of capital, both capital from based in the UK, but also capital that's come into the UK from overseas. Really experienced community advisors with great common interests to ensure that there aren't failures. A very balanced regulatory approach, as much based on principles as rules. I think, and Tom will correct me. I think there's about 60 AIM rules. You compare that AIM rules with the SEC rules. You're talking chalk and cheese. but it's the principles behind that which are important, and also profile. Probably profile is the issue that many companies get for coming to London rather than going to other markets. And again, that's very helpful. Visibility, international markets, and that's been very important over the years. I'll just mention corporate governance in London very quickly. We could take all day on that, but we won't do. And really why, in very simplistic terms, why governance is so important and why it's so important to try and tick those boxes. You know, governance obviously gives confidence to investors, shows the company has quality or perceived quality. You get investor interest, you get liquidity, which is crucial. Based upon liquidity, you get valuation. So that's it. That very simple relationship is understood by most companies, hopefully, and therefore the level of corporate governance in the UK has increased substantially. And that I think is a very important part of why overseas investors are happy to invest in through the London market if the companies which they could probably invest in elsewhere. And just overall, in terms of the just some bullet points, really, in terms of the Quality Company Alliance in the UK, which is the main guidelines used for AIM companies in particular. It's all around ensuring that companies have an efficient and effective, and also a dynamic management framework. They expect companies to be able to adapt to change. Very important. Good communication, confidence builds trust, and confidence and communication. Communicating with the market is very important. I do lots of capital market presentations, and I say to people, if you invest time in the market will invest time in you. And I think that's crucial in terms of getting the benefit out of an IPO, but also in terms of showing good governance. As I mentioned earlier, comply or disclose. Comply with all the rules you can do. If they're not relevant in some cases, disclose why you're not doing it. Even though the market has done well, particularly in the last 2 years, there's always looking for ways to make it more relevant, to make it more competitive. I guess this is one area where Brexit might come in, whereby because of the changes, some of the trading moved to the trading with shares moved into Europe during the first part of the year into Amsterdam. But I'm dealing here more with fundraisings and with IPOs and the raising of capital, not actually where shares are traded. Having said that, the trading of shares has moved back to the UK in the second quarter of the year. I won't go through all these bullet points, but the first four are probably the ones most relevant to London and may also be quite relevant in India as well. The first is a proposal to allow dual class shares and structures whereby there'll be differential voting rights. London is quite keen to see whether or not that can be introduced because it's other exchanges allow that, and obviously it's very important in certain fast growing companies, which are really VC companies, where the staff and when the founders have been incentivized. So that's an area where they're looking at, and quite likely that by the end of the year, the dual class shares or dual class voting share structures will be allowed. We're looking to rebrand and resize in particular, and remarket the standard segments I mentioned earlier, and by size probably that will increase the minimum market capitalization for standard segment companies. There'll be a debate over that, but again it shows that the market is evolving. Free floats, so flexibility is important. On the main markets, technically you need a free float of at least 25%. On AIM, the rules aren't written, but generally they're targeting a free float percentage of about 20%. Having said that, when some very, very large companies come to market, particularly companies like Aramcamp, where the actual free float was very small in percentage terms, it's very big in absolute terms. So I think there's a view there that that there'll be some flexibility in those free float requirements, and there'll probably be an absolute minimum of 15% to allow some flexibility between 25% and 15% for larger companies. And the fourth bullet point talks about SPACs, and you probably can't have a conversation with anybody currently in the world in
Robin, sorry to interject, just time wise, if you could we're just running out of time, so
okay, yeah, I'll be two minutes,
please. Thank you.
And then finally, SPACs on this slide. SPACs are clearly they've been very effective in the US as an attempt in London to try and ensure that there's flexibility as regards the structure going forward. So in terms of Asian markets, Singapore, very high international component, but equity markets have had relatively poor liquidity and relatively low valuations. Very strong compliance makes them generally quite unattractive to smaller emerging companies. Hong Kong still attracting deep pools of capital from local capital, Greater China, still active despite the uncertainties in terms of the world's relationship with mainland China. And the markets of Vietnam and Indonesia are actually coming through as well. Vietnam in particular is evolving quickly. So in terms of all those issues, you know, what can be learned, and what might be useful in terms of India's developments? I think the first point to ensure that there is a balance between investor protection and the entrepreneurial spirit of the companies. Ensure that there's a continued development in the products, technology, market structure, surveillance, enforcement. Try and increase the direct involvement of retail investors in equities, but also in the corporate debt markets, which we talked about earlier on. Try and avoid over onerous controls over parent company jurisdictions and foreign ownership limits. Try and make the market as open as possible. Ensure that your feeder markets are allocating capital directly and efficiently to ensure those companies maybe can then move forward up into the Bombay Exchange and the National Exchange. Carry on looking at developing the scale and reach of the corporate debt market, and try and reduce the dependency on the private placements. You know, engage with the foreign portfolio investors and foreign institutional investors. We talked earlier on about the green markets and the smart city initiative, and generally try and make the market as attractive as possible to both overseas investors, which you're already doing, but actually foreign company listings, which is the key. So that was me. That's it. That's Baker Tilly, and that's me. So thank you very much indeed. I'm sorry I've gone a bit longer, but thank you.
Thanks a lot, Robin. Very informative. 8 very crisp points from the Indian capital market perspective, and giving a larger context of UK market. I was extremely, especially the most powerful that I found was confidence, certainty, and consistency. If you can get that right, I think, you know, any market can become as vibrant as what the London market is. The SPAC is an interesting concept. Let's see how the SPAC piece goes, and especially the secondary fundraising, which has a very where the London actually has a lot of strength, as you rightly mentioned. Interestingly, you did mention about the primary market, and I would like to go to Tom now and just get some deeper perspective into the primary market from the foreign participation perspective. Obviously, Tom's larger experience and especially from the London Stock Exchange, and what are the inputs that he may have from the Indian capital market perspective, and we'll take it from there. So Tom, over to you.
Thank you very much indeed, and it's a great honor to join you this afternoon. I hope you can hear me okay.
Yeah, we can hear you. Thanks, Tom.
I think, you know, first of all, for joining us on a Friday afternoon. Secondly, of course, because I recognize that we're competing with the opening ceremony of the Tokyo Olympics as well. So
you really must be committed
to the capital markets and everything we have to offer. So really delighted to join this afternoon session. I thought I'd do 3 things briefly. One, to just give you a flavour of some things going on in London, and Robin has touched on some of those, so I'll be quite quick on that. Secondly, offer some perspectives on the views of India from an outsider, from the London market, and I think some of that will dovetail again with what Robin said. And thirdly, share some thoughts on areas of collaboration, many of which I think again, have been picked up in some of the earlier comments as well. Look, first of all, it's been a very, very busy time. Robin alluded to it. You know, the market is extremely vibrant. We still have nearly 2,000 companies on our market. It's an over $7 trillion market cap in London. We've raised over $200 billion, or just about $200 billion in equity for companies over the last 3 years. Huge vibrancy in flows. We've had 49 IPOs in the first half of this year. And in fact, in the last couple of weeks of July, that's taken us up to about 65 already, raising nearly $15 billion year to date. So it's been extremely busy. Technology has been a big winner on our markets, particularly in the IPO market. And I'll come back to that in a minute because I think it's relevant. I think sometimes there's a bit of a perception in the outside world that London is very good for old economy stories, but new economy less well understood, and nothing could be further from the truth in terms of the hybrid of capital return. Robin reflected on the international nature of the market. That's absolutely right. It's nearly 40% of the companies in London are non-UK businesses. That's always been the case. If you think back to the roots of the London market financing, you know, international trade missions, when people were still trading by sticking bits of paper on the walls of coffee shops, the technology has changed obviously over the years, but the international nature of the market, you know, really hasn't. And just to bring that back to the flow that we've seen in the market this year, just to give you a flavor for some of the international nature we've seen. We've seen IPOs and new listings this year from companies as far and wide as the US, Canada, Russia, Australia, Israel, Estonia, Denmark, Nigeria, Namibia, and I'm sure I'm missing a few as well. So that international flow is really continuing to come through. Some of the other things in London we're doing is continuing to innovate. The market can't stand still. Markets all around the world, I think, are under pressure to continue to reinvent themselves and be the most attractive they can be, both to issuers and to investors. The quantum of private capital has, over some periods, provided a real sort of existential threat to capital markets, I think. You know, why would I ever need to take a company public if I can get all the capital I need in private markets? In a strange way, I think the experience of COVID is one that has reminded people exactly why you have access to public markets. And those companies that have been listed can react quickly to crises, raise capital quickly from a multitude of investors, have ridden out the crisis by and large very well. And where we're seeing some pain, unfortunately, in the system at the moment is perhaps companies sat in private equity portfolios where they're reliant on one investor who don't necessarily want to put their hand in their pocket again. So I think we continue to innovate. Part of that is about creating new access points. We're spending a lot of time focused on retail investors and democratizing access to our markets through a partnership we launched last year with a business called Primary Bid, which opens up IPOs and follow-on offerings to retail. The green economy mark is one that has already been referred to, but I'll come back to that in a second because that I think is a very interesting area. We've opened up new connections with China, with the Shanghai London Connect. So these are all things that we are up to try and make our market, you know, continue to make it as attractive as possible for investors, issuers, and indeed the advisory community that sits here in London. Of course, we've got a long established deep history with the Indian market already. 36 Indian companies listed on our market, market cap of $360 billion. And a lot of those companies have been listed in London for quite some time. They remain actually very liquid in the London market. So for example, Reliance Industries is one that is in the top 10 securities of all the GDRs traded on our international order book. That traded about $3 billion in the course of 2020. And India's GDRs as a whole group rank third in the IOB just after Russia and South Korea. South Korea, frankly, being just Samsung, which is very liquid in the London market as well. So that's a base on which we feel very confident we can continue to build and partner up in partnership with the ecosystem of India. Some thoughts here on India's market, a little bit of an outside look on the way in. I think for a start, it's a large market now, $3 trillion in market cap, as was highlighted, you know, right from the start. I think the absolutely extraordinary success of the Zomato IPO, which I think you know, attracted a demand of nearly $50 billion, so massively oversubscribed, I think underscores the increasing maturity of the domestic market and the ability to finance large transactions. And indeed, there's an expanding investor base that can participate in those transactions, which I think, you know, many of you on the call would have worked on building up. That said, I think, you know, there remain sort of limitations, and where I think there's you know, quite a good opportunity to partner up. I think that global investor access, that deep those deep pools that you know, can be sought in London that Robin referred to, I think you know, remains something that you know, we can support with. Those companies that are looking for international acquisition currency, for example, who want widely internationally accepted paper, London listed stocks have been used in acquisitions in 66 different countries in the last 5 years, more than any other paper listed on any exchange in the world. index passive demand out of London is huge. And with more and more money going from active to passive everywhere around the world, the value of being part of an index becomes more and more important. And I think the whole ambitious green and sustainability program in India is ambitious, but really could benefit hugely from further access to dedicated green and ESG funds and the ecosystem that really supports that, which I think has been really, if you look down those bullets on the right hand side, these are all things that London has spent a lot of time focusing on in recent years and where we think that the partnership can widely prosper. We see the forthcoming overseas listing policy as a great opportunity. We think great potential to support India's economy, give companies access to a wider and more diverse pool of global capital. That will enhance competitiveness of those companies in terms of access to finance and diversify their funding sources. So we see that new policy as one which really opens up new opportunities. And as Robin said, I won't repeat his statistics, they're down in black and white for you there, or color. But that London, we think provides a shop window into a very wide and diverse global pool of investors that, as and when Indian companies are thinking about overseas listings, we hope they think about London as someone who's welcoming of international businesses, is outward looking, actively welcomes those corporates, perhaps in a way that the US in recent years has become a little bit more inward looking, and in some cases, particularly China, outright hostile towards international listings on market. I mentioned the vibrant tech sector. I won't spend too much time on this, but I think again, got many tech names in India, those which are consumer brand names like Zomato. I think clear that they're going to get some massive response that they did. But I think other sort of more deep tech B2B type businesses can benefit from the ecosystem in London that's evolved, and as I say, the very vibrant capital raisings that we've seen, including many international businesses as well. Avast from the Czech Republic, Tiny Build from the US, Trustpilot from Denmark, Just Eat Takeaway, a Dutch business. So just really underscoring London's ability to finance international tech in partnership. I won't spend any time on index demand. I'm conscious of time, but that in London is something that we do spend a bit of time focused on. The active to passive trend globally is absolutely there. We can't ignore it. And that's something, again, through the FTSE indices, companies can track. ESG is an absolutely key element. I think Robin put it very nicely, the kind of rhetoric all around the world of building back better, not letting a good crisis go to waste, if you like. What can we do to make sure that as we come through the other side of that, that we're giving investors the right tools to transition their portfolios, we're giving issuers the right tools to help transition to the low carbon world that we all need to inhabit to get to net zero. And this is a huge theme. It's the fastest growing pot of assets in the UK, $20 billion at the moment, but rising very, very quickly indeed. And that's something, again, as I think about partnership opportunities, that Indian companies, particularly with the focus on energy mix and the huge infrastructure develops that we needed in that sector, it's an unbelievably good opportunity to support there. As I said, sustainability and green, huge focus in London, whether it's on the index side, our sustainable and green bond market, now over $100 billion raised in that market with 300 sustainable bonds, not just green, but also social bonds, sustainable bonds, we've had water bonds, but also transition bonds, which launched this year as a subsegment of that, which again reflects that not every company is green, but every company needs to make that transition and needs to be seen to be making the right steps to support the global cause. And that is an area where, again, we're seeing a huge amount of interest. The green economy mark Robin referred to, but we've now got 100 companies that meet that requirement. It's been a great advertisement, way to advertise the green credentials of a company. And in fact, in the latest report that we put out this week, the 101 green economy mark companies have actually outperformed the broader market by 5% this year. So actually, you can start to see that distorting effect in a positive way of funds chasing increasing green opportunities. So I think as I look at more broadly at the opportunities, I think depth of market, international access, London as a part of supporting that, our focus on sustainability and green with the vast quantums of capital that India will need to raise, and a tech sector in India that's growing hugely, but as an ecosystem in London with tech research, et cetera, which can support, you know, the growth of that and supports much international tech, I think would be the key things I would highlight as ways in which we can incorporate. You can see our ugly mugshots on this slide. I won't spend any time on that, just to say that we do obviously have, Mohan based in Delhi and a team of us here. I hope that the slides will be circulated to all attendees, and we're here to help. So do feel free to get in touch with any of us if you want to have further information.
Yeah, thanks so much, Tom. Let me tell you, though it was Olympic opening ceremony or Friday happy hour, it was worth every bit of it. And I'm glad that you participated on this side as opposed to anything else. It's actually phenomenal. You have covered a lot of topic and a lot of pertinent ones. One unique thing that came out was clearly on the passive side, where the global penetration is like in the double digit and maybe more. And in India, we are still a very, very, very preliminary in that space. And you're right, that actually links with the benchmarking, be it equity, be it fixed income, the global bonds, and these things. So very right, a lot of opportunities, a lot of specific focus points. And just one more thing I know before I move on to my next speaker, that I saw the Euro Cup and I was up till 4 in the morning. And Tom and Robin will probably appreciate that, but I would like to go to Gianluca, who probably must be the most excited person on that day at 4 a.m. India time. I know the good memories will still be there. Yeah, so. Over to you.
Can you see the slides?
Yep, we can.
So first of all, thanks a lot for the invitation to talk at Associam and for the selection of the time scheduling that is perfect for Italy. So what I will do now is to present you an overview that is considering the European point of view and the difference between India and Europe in terms of financial markets. So what I will try to do is to give you an overview about what are the strengths and the weaknesses of the Indian economy that may matter for a foreign investor that is looking for another country, an international country in which the money can be invested. Talking about the difference, I will focus first of all on the equity market. Here you can see a simple plot about the Eurostock 50 and the Standard & Poor's Bombay Stock Exchange Sensex Index. As you can see, by comparing these two lines, the blue line that is Europe and the red line that is India, there is a difference in the trend of the market that may matter for an international investor. Here you have the average daily returns by investing in India versus Europe. And most important here, you have a simple correlation measure that tells us that the two markets are related because the correlation is positive, but the correlation is not so high. What does it mean? That if I do cherry picking and I select some companies in India for investing, probably I can exploit also some advantages related to diversification opportunities. So there could be an interest for diversification strategy. What else I've done, I selected two indexes only from the Indian country. One is the Nifty 50 and the other is the Nifty Small Cap. Again, you have here the average daily return, but most important here, you have a correlation measure. What does the correlation measure tell us is that the two performance are strictly related. So what is important for an international investor is not only to look at the big players that are working in India, but there could be also an interest to invest in companies that are small and medium enterprises in India. So there could be an interest, and the interest could be worthy even for small players, and so may support the development of your economy. What else I've done is to focus on the bond market, mostly important time focusing on the sovereign bond market. Yeah, what you have is the return of the bond issued by the Indian government from the time 2011 up to 2021. Yeah, you have as benchmark the German Bund. As you can see, there is a huge gap between the return of the bond that you are offering as Indian government and the return that is offered in Germany. This result is not surprising and is reasonable, because you know that the Bund and the Germany are classified by the rating agencies as triple A, so they are the safer country that you can find worldwide. And on the basis of the last data that we have on India, you are near to a speculative grade, because you are triple B or triple BAA and so on. What matters for us is to compare the return that you are offering, not with the German Bund, because you will never offer a return that is similar, but you can compare it with some countries in Europe that have almost the same level of rating. Which are them? For example, Italy and Portugal, that are currently rated triple B by the rating agencies, and they are offering a return that is significantly lower than the Indian one. The Italian bond, 10-year bond, is offering 0.6% as return. The Portuguese one is offering 0.23 as return. What does it mean? That for investors that are looking to buy sovereign bonds and are looking for speculative investment bonds, not safer ones, probably there is a market also for the Indian financial industry, because the return that you are offering is significantly more competitive with respect to countries with the same rating, but based in Europe. What is important also is try to understand how your asset management industry is working. And in order to do it, I collected some data from the Association of Mutual Funds in India and some data for benchmark from the European Fund and Asset Management Association in Europe. Here you have the volume of asset under management, so the total asset, and on the basis of the last data available, you have 34 trillions of rupees outstanding as total assets. Here you have a plot about Europe, the overall plot and the plot by country, in which we have as amount outstanding 23,000 billions of euro in all the countries of the European Union. Here it was before Brexit, so the UK is still included. If we make a ratio between this amount of asset under management outstanding and the GDP produced on overall Europe, the value is 132. So we have a huge amount of asset under management outstanding with respect to the real production. This result is driven by mainly the UK, the Switzerland, the Netherlands, and the Denmark. UK and Netherlands and Switzerland, because they are big financial centers in Europe. Denmark probably also because the GDP of Denmark is not so big, and so the ratio is high, also because the denominator is low. For you, it depends on the month or the year that you are considering. The value of the asset under management outstanding with respect to the GDP, by considering only the mutual funds, is only 10 to 15%. What does it mean? That you have a huge growth opportunity for developing this market and for collecting money from national investors, but also international ones. Talking about the investors, what we have is also a different composition about the type of investors. This is a plot taken from, again, the Association of Mutual Funds in India, that tells us that on the basis of the last data available, around the 54% of the money invested comes from individuals, and the 46 is coming from institutionals. If we do the same analysis for Europe, what we can find is something that is totally different, because in Europe, on average, we have that the 72% of money is coming from institutional investors, while only the 28% is coming from the individual investor. This means that the asset management industry in India has a problem related to institutional players that has to grow in the future in order to support the growth of the market. What else is important is that when we talk about India, we look about institutions that are investing in India. The percentage of foreigners that are investing in India is still too low with respect to other benchmarks worldwide. So what you need to do is to look for international investors, institutional investors that may be interested for your market. Lastly, what I want to present you is the type of asset that you need to offer to the institutional investors if you want to attract them. Here you have again the type of financial instruments that you have outstanding in India. Let's look at the last data available. The main asset class are equity-oriented schemes, so equity investment, mainly equity investment. After you have debt investment products, and the third category are the money market instruments. The last one that was decreased a little bit during the last years was the ETF and fund of funds. If we do the same analysis in order to understand what are looking for in Europe as investment opportunity, we can find some differences. Why we can find some differences? Because the first category of investment for investors in EU is a bond product. So funds that are investing in bonds, mainly sovereign bonds, sometimes also corporate bonds and so on. The second category is equity. The third category is a category that is including ETF, hedge funds and so on. So special type of, let's say, asset management products. The less relevant category is the one related to cash and money instruments. So what we can learn from this comparison is that up to now you have an overweight about money instruments that probably will be not requested by foreign investors. You have too much exposure in equity with respect to bond, and you need to develop something that is more focused on bond, talking about sovereign bonds, but also corporate bonds, green bonds, and all this stuff. This is something that is missed and probably may help the Indian market to grow and to attract money from abroad. What we can learn at the end is that we can be attractive in India as a market for investing because the return is quite good and is not fully correlated with the European one. So if you make a cherry picking, you can take also advantages of diversification strategy. The low and negative bond returns that are affecting all the European countries and the developed countries may be a driver of a growth of demand for bonds in India. And the asset management industry has to still grow, especially by looking to institutional investors that are coming from abroad. Thanks for the time you spent in listening to me.
Thanks, Gianluca. Very informative, especially in the last slide where you concluded. Could not agree with you more on the two key pieces. One is clearly on the bond side, there's a lot that can be done, from benchmarking to the opening up of the limits and the larger participation from sovereign to the corporate side, and clearly very interesting and eye-opener in the amount of opportunity which is there in the asset management industry with the 10x more growth that can be leveraged upon, especially when, as I mentioned earlier, that returns and experience would be the true thing that probably would make India as a preferred destination. And you clearly saw that returns probably are already there. It's just the experience and the more policy push can probably help us tap a lot of opportunities which is out there. It is for us to now put it together. Understood. It was very, very informative. Thank you so much. I would now move on to the next one, Pankaj. Pankaj probably can give us some insight because he invests heavily in Indian markets. and can give some perspective from his hands-on experience, from the funds perspective, funds raising perspective, or any other operational or the policy matters. So Pankaj, over to you. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Can you just share the presentation? Once again, share content. Sorry, is there a way?
Yes, sir.
Now you can check. Yeah, okay, I'm sharing the content. One second.
There you go.
Yep. Yes, there you are. Share.
There you go.
Okay, you see this?
Yep.
Okay. Thank you. I assume everyone is able to see the presentation which is in front of me. So we are an asset management company based out of Singapore. We invest globally, emerging markets across China, especially Russia, Mexico, Thailand, Indonesia. And we have investments in India, and India has been, our base for, we have a research team there. And we have an office in France where we have our directors. Yeah, just in a global context, what do we have? We have, India has become part of the world per se. What you're seeing is the GDP vis-a-vis the market cap. And what we find is that given there is a lot of scope for India to increase both of these, as you said, we are targeting a 5 trillion economy. I think it'll happen sooner. You see the number of listed, why I put this slide is there are a lot of listed companies in India, despite the total market cap being smaller. And I assume that the market cap will get bigger. We have Zomato listing, and the market cap number will probably be much higher as we go ahead. Now, I'm giving you a context of, a small little brief about what we've experienced in India. It's come a long way. In the 70s, it was meant restricted largely to Mumbai or maybe fewer people who would access the markets, whichever. Debt market hasn't kind of developed. But it was purely equities then, but in a small way. And now it's available to the wide spectrum, and we are seeing the democratization of access being available to Indians, and you're seeing what it has done to the markets itself. Now, that's the availability of money. Capital markets essentially allows entrepreneurs to raise capital, and that's what India has already done. Now, I specifically focus on regulation, as one of my colleagues earlier said, regulation is so very key. Now, Singapore MAS has developed a level of confidence amongst all other parts of the developed world. And it is considered a comparable jurisdiction in terms of regulation. And that's what allows investors to be comfortable to put their money there. India is getting there. It has done a lot in regulation, and I'll talk about the interesting points which have gone on. It has been largely investor-centric, as in there has been safety focus, dematerialization of shares happened, investor protection fund came in, segregation of depositories to ensure safety has happened. The risk management is world-class. The derivatives are unbelievably good. Very well-managed margining system. It has protected minority shareholders with regulations on primary issues, reservation for retail so that they don't get crowded out. Secondary issues, the pricing of... So the regulation on really all these parameters is there what's really needed in India, and it's kind of reached to nice standards. Stakeholders are now consulted for taking decisions. I participated in some of them for which was affecting us. Shortcomings in policies are recognized quickly. There was a small cap, large cap classification, misclassification, and things were put back in order and the markets became normal again. Very quick to act. I would give my thumbs up to that. The decentralization of the FI registration process was a very nice positive. I will talk about what we can do further. This allows a private entity to onboard an FII, and which has made things a lot more easier. There are fantastic new initiatives. The global investing is allowed in India now. So people like us sitting outside can actually, this is a business for us. We manage money for high net worth clients in India or for their global investments. So global investing is now possible. Gujarat as a gift city has done fantastic. I think a very conducive environment has been created as a tax-friendly zone. So we as a foreign investor can actually set up an office in India and operate as if we are not constrained by the domestic laws. I think it's what, of course, is needed is a lot more happening there. It's happening a little bit slow, but you'll have global depositories available, so which will allow us to work in a place like India, which is, you know, friendlier for families and friends, for Indians outside to come back and operate out of India. I think that's very nice. Now let's move on to the key points which I actually wanted to highlight in this presentation. Really, I have just jotted down haphazardly, so you could, you know, we can go about on them at a later stage on what order. But there is this small thing about best execution. When you give an order, the BSE and NSE, the two exchanges, still you need to search where the best order should go. There have been certain rules on them, but it's not been automated. I don't know what holds it apart, what's the technology behind, but I think that's a small level of change. In terms of reporting, I must bring to your notice, we invest in a country like Philippines, we invest in Thailand, and the amount of balance sheet disclosures, the quarterly disclosures are mind-blowing. A country like India, which is so good in technology, to not have a mandatory quarterly reporting of balance sheet, I think it can be done. I mean, you know, it should be made mandatory. You cannot be having a balance sheet being reported 6 monthly. I think these are small nuances, but it increases confidence as we talk about. Now, what's the need of the hour for India? It's deepening of the debt markets. Globally, the debt markets are, you know, 5 times, 10 times the equity. It means it would improve the economic benefits for Indians per se, lower the cost of debt, lower the cost of money, which has been its biggest problem so far. I must also bring to highlight the process of the issue of convertible bonds. We were at one point of time investors in convertible bonds in India. Oh, but the legal system, people, the companies took us. We were not repaid our money, and it was quite a disaster because we would land up in courts, but that's not our job. We want to go into courts and the legal system not supportive for that. I can tell you our convertible bond business or segment is an immensely popular segment in other parts of the world. It allows a legal system which allows this to happen and convert brings this business back to India would be a fantastic thing to happen. Now, what's one very key important? So you have India is now known as an emerging market. Why is it called an emerging market? Because the policies tend to happen, the change often. It's still developing. There is no surety of policy. But I think India is getting towards a developed market, and given the past, what we've seen in the last 2-3 years. I'm just giving you a small example. VAT in Singapore will be increased to 9%. This was announced 3 to 4 years in advance. So you have the participants actually planning and understanding that 3 years from now, this change will happen, or 4 years from now. That's the kind of time frame when decisions need to be taken with or being implemented. Of course, there will be critical decisions to be taken and then, but it's not necessarily firefighting. There needs to be a little bit of longer term thinking. In case of FIIs, as I said, there was one very positive thing of getting them account opening from a private sector. I would suggest we need have one window approach where FIIs issues can be resolved at one shot. You know, I don't need to go to a PwC to ask them about my taxes. I need not go to RBI to ask them about, you know, whether my FII, whether the money can be remitted back or put in. You need one supporting entity. Maybe it's the depository, maybe some consulting agency who handles everything for you. And that would be a fantastic positive approach from the government side. Regulation, as I said, confidence building is extremely important. There are issues we read that, you know, certain aspects, some cases hanging on in SEBI and SAT. Quick action on that takes a long time. I mean, I think that would bring in a lot more confidence amongst investors. I must also bring to highlight is about the KYC. The approach really, okay, in India, it may be, you know, I don't want to be offensive. I want to put it in a way that when you have an investor coming in, the first approach is, oh, maybe he's doing something wrong, rather than saying, oh, he's doing right. If we find something wrong, that's no, we will disallow him. So the approach needs to change. You should be more welcoming. Let's say, for example, NRIs, we have about 32 million NRIs globally, okay? That's a huge opportunity. These are the top 1% in terms of wealth, and they are very wealthy Indians across the world. They have, I can tell you that if you want to open an AIF or a PMS account in India for an NRI, he would need to go to the embassy, sit there, get his passport attested. I mean, where in the world where a document needed by the government, created by government of India, needs a verification process at the embassy? I think process, I mean, in India, you open an account instantly on the digital space. I think we need to allow these kind of facilities, allow NRIs in sync with domestic, some at par with domestic investors. They are a huge source of funds and a huge source of money. Moving to taxation on NRI cash flow mismatches, I think there are certain cash flow taxation issues for NRIs which need to be resolved. We can talk about that later sometime if we want. Maybe some incentives for private equity at the time of exit, so that they get some kind of reward for the risk they are taking in India. India has always been a capital short economy. So that's largely what I have to cover. I hope it's all in a very, very positive sense. I think India is meant for many, many years of future positives. We would be happy to contribute in whatever way, in our suggestions, in our investing. And thank you very much for having me on this presentation. Thank you, Mr. Lahoti.
Thanks, Pankaj. Very, very good insight into various key points, and especially at the granular level. That's where a lot of experience matters. One key point on global investing by India, that is definitely is becoming one of the key points, as you rightly mentioned, that India is part of a world now. Clearly, two key pillars and the levers, and a very powerful statement. One is, as we are getting $5 trillion and maybe becoming bigger, it is transforming India from emerging market to a developed market. Phenomenal point. And I think it requires a real long-term roadmap kind of the approach. And second is on the approach itself, which as you rightly mentioned, is the overall construct and approach, and lots can be done in that space. I will probably, as we are going to compile all this and we are going to make a presentation to the authorities, I'm pretty sure that a lot of these points will be looked into. I will now move on to the next participant, next panelist, Saurabh, Dr. Agarwal. In the interest of time, I would not take much of the time introduction, but Saurabh brings a lot of expertise and experience of the financial markets. And please, if you could add more points and give us some perspective as to how to make this more vibrant. Over to you, Saurabh.
Yeah. So respected Lav Chaturvedi ji, Professor Gyan Vikram Atroki, CA Atul Kumar Gupta ji, and the team, DS Rajora ji, Ankit Krishna, KL Gupta, Pradeep Gupta, other speakers, and my dear participants. I'm only 5 minutes away when the program should close. So I'll keep it very short, but I am speaking on a very important topic, Indian capital markets from the perspective of international perspective. Now, when I thought of international perspective, I thought of gold and the golden period, and Chanakya Niti came to my mind, and a quote from Chanakya, Bhagyavantam Parishena Karintam Shri Parite Ji. What does it mean? Don't start a work without examining the opportunity. And Indian capital markets today present a huge opportunity for all investors across the globe. And that is why I must congratulate the team, Lav Chaturvedi ji, the entire team, which is working day and night to put across this. Why Indian capital markets? India has a huge population, and our population has a huge home bias. Unlike Americans, US only 73% in US, rest abroad. UK, only 50% in UK rest all their investments abroad. Indians, on the other hand, spend 98% to 100% of their investment in India only. So yeah. Indian capital markets, whether it is equities, whether it is treasury bills, whether it is commodities market, it is has a huge potential. And the potential has been seen particularly during the COVID times, when even when the FPIs took out their money, our market still continued to go up. But it this entire discussion comes with a pinch of salt, because today our the share of our market is only 2 to 3% of the global stock markets. So there's a long way where I think Professor Gianluca has done a beautiful job in from various websites. We have to maintain growth post-tax, post-inflation purchasing power of invested capital at adequate rate of return. It is this which will bring global investors in India. In India, investment also makes sense, because almost the Indian rupee has an annual depreciation of 4 to 6%. The depreciation has an impact of making stocks cheaper for international participants. So every time, so this time they have come in for Zomato. When they come back for LIC, I think with the devaluation in rupee, you can get more of LIC stock. So I think our stocks also become attractive because of annual depreciation of 4 to 6%, which adds to the return which is being given, inflation adjusted returns. And it was this reason that FPI inflows were positive from September 2020 to March 2021, almost $5.5 billion worth of investment. But in April 2021, we saw an outflow, and there where the domestic institutional investors come in. And I would compliment the work of Professor Gianluca. They, you know, in India, a something called as a systematic investment plan, NPS, has come in. These intermediaries, mutual funds, insurance, NPS, provident fund, banks, they are all investing regularly in Indian capital markets. So even if you blindly invest in ETFs, exchange traded funds, you are making money. And it is forecasted that India will become the fourth largest private wealth market globally by 2028. I think as India moves towards the $5 trillion GDP and we have achieved the $3 trillion, it will not take time where we become a $6 trillion capital market. It will not take much time. And it is this growth which I think foreign portfolio investors can sense. And despite all the odds which Mr. Chopra was pointing out, that you have to get your passport attested, still they are taking all the efforts to invest in Indian markets. And I will quote the data of financial year 2021 till now, from January till now, $2.74 trillion worth of FPI investment has come in. I think why Indian capital markets are doing it, one is the quarter one earnings of IT companies. IT has boomed like anything, and we must thank companies like TCS, Infosys, Wipro for doing a great job for the Indian capital markets. Supportive macroeconomic data, primarily promoted by the strong government policies, improvement in monsoon, and this is the reason all our benchmark indices, Sensex or Nifty, all are at their all-time high. We are seeing big companies, not only traditional like LIC, IRCTC, even Zomato, big tech companies coming in. I will quote now some data from 2019, 1 year return on index. In 2019, Nifty 50, 13.98, Sensex 16.16, Dow Jones 22.22, S&P 27.76, NASDAQ 33.86. And in 2019, had Ashocham done it, I would have said invest globally. But today, in 2021, I will quote the data, year to date return on Nifty is 13.18, Dow Jones 13.78, NASDAQ 13.794, S&P 16. Idea is even KOSPI 13.26, JCI Jakarta 2.65. We are doing much, much better in all the BRIC countries compared our returns with global gold standards, and we are doing equally good with them. And I think I must thank the leaders in Indian economy. The economy is strong. Industries like bank, IT, hospital, pharma, auto, they are strong, but we have laggards also. The hotel sector, the media sector, they are bringing down the performance. And with now, as Shri Atul Gupta ji pointed out, we are now going to have ESG, Environment, Sustainable Governance Reporting. This, I remember your lecture last time, and wonderful, I studied. Once we have that ESG thing, I can tell you, our reporting will be not less than the gold standards. I think a lot has been done by SEBI. Thanks to SEBI, thanks to ASSOCHAM for pulling up SEBI and the government. And I must tell you, we need to work hard. Efforts are being made to liberalize the treasury bill, the government security, SDL market. I think greater retail participation, both of Indians and abroad, will boost the treasury bill market. Our debt market is not good, but now debt fund market is coming in, which is taking the market further. Also, STT and the CTT, commodity transaction tax, should be bought in line with the global peers. Until we cannot achieve global efficiency if such taxes continue to disrupt the efficiency of our markets. Shares of private companies should be made available on the traded in DVAT form on this platform, so that global players like SoftBank and so forth, they should invest in them. They are not listed, but you can sell it to global players through the exchange. So everything is recorded and proper tax is paid. I think if this one suggestion which I'm making, it can take our stock market from $3 trillion to anywhere between $4.5 to $5 trillion if private company shares are available on stock market. And even private people have to buy, they must buy through the exchange and not personal deal, which is to be reported. Lastly, the government must rationalize either STT or long-term capital gain. Both do not do good. I think we must do good to our investors. We scratch their back, they will scratch ours, and together we will be the strongest and the fastest growing capital markets of the world. Thank you, and Jai Hind.
Jai. Dr. Agarwal, there's a reason why you're my personal favorite. Thank you so much for that passionate inputs. With the data, backed with the data, with the $6 trillion opportunity, and what a fantastic point on providing platform to the private companies and propelling this at a different level by providing an experience, ease, transparency, disclosure, everything addressed at one go. You know, very heartening. We're going to put it together, and needless to say, our pain on STT and CTT, that journey will continue, and we will continue to keep bringing it up till it gets addressed. But thank you so much, Dr. Agarwal. That was very informative. And moving on to the last but not the least, Atul, I would just specifically from the legal stability, and I think few panelists mentioned about the enforcement being one of the key criteria, and the legal policies and the stability, which is one of the key inputs that is required to get the favorable environment. Atul, if you could just throw some light on that and anything else that you can add, so that we can that can make our economy and our markets more vibrant and facilitate the participation. Atul, over to you. Atul, you there? Atul, you're on the mute. Atul, you're on the mute. I think he's speaking, but I'm just trying to. Atul? Can't hear you. I think there is some issue. He's trying to fix it. No luck, Atul, yet. Atul? Oh, I think we're having some problem. I don't think we can hear him.
Atulji, please try with your phone,
yeah,
I think.
With your,
that time it was, you know, very clear.
Yeah, we could hear him earlier. I think it must be the earphone. Atul, you want to... Atul, can you hear us? You can hear us? Okay, so he can hear us, but we can't hear you. Yeah, we can't hear him, but he can hear us. I think he's just trying. We'll just give it up some time. I'm also trying to see. One sec. Hello? I think Atul is fine. He was fine earlier. Atul, you're trying something? I think it's... I think we're having a problem, so I will just I've just suggested him to try without earphone. I think there may be a problem with the earphone, so
maybe with mobile. I think he could do it with mobile. Last time he did it with mobile.
Okay, so I'm going to just ask him.
Yeah, if we can, you can do it on mobile, you know.
I think he just logged out. So while, obviously, we'll wait for Atul to come back, but I was just like, Atul? Okay, still trying. So while we are waiting for Atul, I would just, you know, summarize some of the key points that got mentioned. Once Atul is live, we will hear him out. I know we have kind of stretched on the timeline. Times that we have, and I think we are like 10 minutes over our scheduled time, but we probably can stretch it by another 5-10 minutes. There are a lot of points that got discussed today, starting with the green and the trillion dollar economy, trillion dollar opportunity that is there in the green bonds. Then there was points on the trust and confidence and how the social climate and some of those responsibilities can help us.
Are you able to hear me now?
Yeah, now we can hear you. There you go, Atul. All set. Atul.
Yeah. Thanks, Love. Thanks. And the SOGM for giving this opportunity and some technical hiccups in the last minute. I'm aware that we are already 11 minutes ahead of our schedule. So I will not take much of your time. Maybe 3-4 minutes only I will be speaking.
Okay.
And I appreciate the views shared by Ajay ji, Saurabh ji, and even Pankaj ji and other colleagues that it is very, very important for all of us to see that if we are looking for the country to achieve the 5 trillion economy or even the 10 trillion economy down the line, that we have to see that how we are bringing the new reforms in the system, which will become, I will say, the pathway, or which will offer the ecosystem to bring the more and more capital into the country. As the rightly the program, the structure and the entire topic which envisar that how the capital market can bring the international money resources into the country and the ecosystem around that. So a lot of things have been discussed and deliberated by our colleagues. I just wish to add a few things into that. That Pankaj ji talked about the regulatory aspect and you also shared that how we can when we are looking for the international market vis-a-vis the Indian market, a lot of similarities are being shared by the our colleagues from the University of Italy. I just wish to share that we also conducted as a ICI when I was the president ICI that we conducted a survey with the around 43 countries that what how the when we are looking for the investments into the country, how the ecosystem is supporting. So the first take will be that when we are looking for the more and more capital, which is the need of the hour to have the 5 trillion or 10 trillion economy, we have to see that the ecosystem to bring the investment should be more attractive, should be more facilitating as compared to the today's environment. I just wish to give you the 4-5 points which will is the outcome of this study. The complete study is much larger. That for example, there is no mechanism available for a single window clearance. So you have to have a lot of things as mentioned by Pankaj ji also, that in case you want to bring the investment into India, and as such there is no ready reckoner or some complete procedure is available in the public domain. And finally, the time bound clearance of the proposal. So these are the few aspects which are very, very important in case you want to have the more investment into India. The another aspect which is very I will say I was astonished, like I was surprised to see that if we compare with the other jurisdictions, specifically the Singapore and other countries, at the time which has been taken to form a company, say so for example somebody want to start his operation in India vis-a-vis some other country, the time which we are taking is actually need to rework. We need to rework on that particular aspect. Today, if you ask me the name approval process, the name restricted are there, even the file size which have been given, the 6 MB which make the documents ineligible, like illegible, is something the apostille requirement, that requirement of the resident directors. And the other initial another challenge, like for example that for the winding up of the company you require the 2 years lean period, and the DIN, once you have taken the DIN you can't surrender the DIN. All these things are there which are actually making the investment a roadblockers for the investment. So once we will have this kind of a mechanism, and even I can tell you that if you are looking for the equity route and you have to go with the authorized dealer route, it is taking even the at times it is taking the 3 months to 6 months to get the approval from the authorities to get the money from the overseas. So all these things are there when you have to work upon, apart from the regulatory aspect which the Pankaj ji mentioned, that how the stability in the legal system and the more and more transparency in the reporting can be achieved is something that we need to work upon to achieve the target which the SOCHM and all our colleagues are discussing. The another important topic which the Saurabh ji also hinted out when I deliberated in the last program is the new mechanism, the ecosystem for a more sustainable sustainability, that okay, the protection to the investment is the ESG reporting. And I am happy to intimate to all my colleagues that India is one of the pioneer into the ESG reporting, though through the BRSR, that is business responsibility and sustainable reporting, wherein the top 1000 companies with the market capitalization has to mandatorily report on the BRSR from the 1st of April 2022. But again, I will say that when we are discussing about this, we need to understand the global developments as well. Today, the GRI is merged with the this IIRC with merged with the SASB, and it is the process of establishing the sustainability standard board is there in the next few days or a month. If there will be a establishment of a sustainability standard board, which aims that how we can integrate the financial data with the non-financial data and make the reporting more accountable, transparent, and conducive for the environment, society, as well as for the governance perspective when we are discussing about this. So all these things are there. I am aware that there is a very like the paucity of the time is there, so I am not explaining all these things, but
just to share with you that when we are looking for this 5 trillion or 10 trillion, it is very, very important that we need to review every, like every time we have to review the entire process, the entire ecosystem, and how the we can build the trust from the local investors as well as from the global investors. Our colleagues shared that there is a more the individual investors are investing the money as compared to the institutional investors. And that is something that very, very important to protect the interest of the common man, the common investor who is depositing the hard-earned money. And that actually brings the more and more, I will say, the vibrancy into the entire system. So with this right now, because the time is essence, and I have taken already the 5-6 minutes as compared to we should be closing the session at 6 o'clock. So once again, thanks to the SOCM and all of our colleagues for their wonderful thoughts, the various experience, global experience shared. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much, Atul. It's not the quantity that matters, it's the quality that matters. And in just few minutes, you have been able to highlight a lot of key points. Obviously, like we are in a process of putting all this together and making representation, and each of these points are very relevant with regard to the experience and ease of onboarding that you mentioned. We all know that we have stretched on our timeline, but it's all worth it, according to me. I would just like to now, obviously there is not much time for the participation of our participants, but I could just assure you that on behalf of SOCHAM, that each of the participant can reach out to SOCHAM and any one of us individually with what, hello? Yeah, I would reach out to us individually. Or any points that got presented today, if there is any clarification, any discussion, we are here to have the inclusive, have the participation, and then put our thoughts together. So I encourage each of the participants together to reach out to the panelists individually through SOCHAM, and please give your thoughts, perspective, inputs, that we can take it forward. And with regard to some of the key thoughts that I have been able to gather today from our eminent panelists is clearly in the ESG area, in the passive bonds area, passive equity area, clearly in the overall consistency, confidence, certainty, having the enforcement, the global investment opportunities, fixing the granular nuances, trying to accomplish through the proper roadmap as we transform from whatever emerging to the developed, to the 5 trillion to 10 trillion, or even for that matter, just have a larger participation through the GIFT City. There is a whole bunch of the ideas that have come together. It's very heartening to see that all these ideas point to only one and only one outcome, is that sky is the limit. If we do it well, if we continue to do some good things that have been done so far, and if we can strengthen some of the areas which we have kind of got experience into, and improvise on some areas through proper representation to the authorities and take them along and address the issues that they may be probably grappling with collectively with the industry participants and the global experience like Tom, Robin, Gianluca, and Pankaj, and all other panelists. I think we can achieve a lot. SOCHAM will definitely continue to work towards this along with all participants. I want to personally again thank Jigar, Ajay, Robin, Tom, Gianluca, Pankaj, for letting us know insights from the very diverse perspective, and get the participants to hear directly from what it will take for us to take it to the next level. Like I said, I encourage all the participants to please get in touch with each one of us individually, collectively through the forum, and let's take this discussion and let's continue this momentum. So with that, I would like to thank everybody. If SOCHAM, Mr. Rajora, we are okay, then we can end this session. If there's anything else we need to cover, Mr. Rajora or SOCHAM.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman, and I join Mr. Chaturvedi in conveying my grateful thanks to all the eminent speakers and all the participants. And it's time to close, and we will be in touch with you. with a new discussion. So thank you always being with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Jai Hind.
Thanks very much indeed.
Thank you so much. Bye bye. Have a good weekend.
Thanks. Bye bye. You too. Have a good weekend. Bye bye. Take care. Cheers.
Bye-bye. Bye.